Joined here by Frodan. We're about to get into the second winner's match on day one of the tournament. It's going to be Forsen versus StrifeCro. Both players had pretty close matches in their opening rounds, so it'll be curious to see how they'll play out here. Pretty different decks, I guess. I mean, they both have Druid, they both have Shaman. We kind of expected that, but Mage is only brought by Forsen, and Rogue is a fairly unpopular deck. Now that we've seen Rogue play out a few times, how do you see it, Frodan? Do you still have the positive light, or is the negativity flowing through?
I gotta be honest, man. I think it's actually a pretty cool inclusion, because I think what the Rogue is trying to do is kill the third deck. Druid and Shaman, I think they're understanding that it might drop a game, but it most likely will win the game and send it to game five. So the difference maker will be like killing whatever you think the third deck is. And if people are bringing more control, like the dragon oriented stuff, it's definitely very good against that kind of thing.
Yeah.
The priest, even the warrior to a certain extent. The rogue's really good at season tempo. Force is not one of those people, though. He brought a little bit more of an aggressive lineup, and I think that's going to ultimately be the undoing. So I'm giving Force the slight edge here. But at the same time, that tempo mage is extremely volatile. Sometimes it's the reason you lose, because it just can't draw like correctly at all.
Yeah, I mean, it seemed that was the case against Forsen's game against Kibler's Warrior, but somehow a win just happened out of nowhere with like extreme Flame Waker value.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll have to see.
The Onyxia. we thought maybe that was the sticking a fork in the game, but at the same time, because the Flame Waker end up surviving just by the skin of its teeth, end up being able to clear everything. Probably not going to be the same scenario here at all, because I anticipate both these guys might do the same kind of opening, either Druid or Shaman. I don't think either of them is really incorrect here. And then going from there, just kind of piloting whatever you feel like is best. Mm-hmm. It's pretty ironic that we see Shaman be so dominant in terms of lineups, because I think everyone for a long time was making jokes at, you know, there's tier one with Druid, Paladin, and then there's tier two with like Freeze Mage and Reno Lock. Tier three is like Oil Rogue, and then tier four is just all Shaman deck, every single Shaman deck in existence.
Well, at least they made the tiers, right? I mean, for some time before that, they weren't even there.
Yeah. I mean, they joked that it was tier one, tier two, tier three, and then tier Shaman. That was kind of what they mentioned. So that was the nomenclature.
Yeah. But, I mean, the Shaman deck that we're seeing is... I feel like if it wasn't Shaman, it would just be another class that would do it about as well. Just like the aggro face push type of theme. So I don't know. I think Shaman is so cool, but I think the coolness of Shaman has to do with like buffs and control and like totem synergies and, you know, milling, like just running down your opponent with valuable totems, that kind of stuff. The charge your opponent and then kill him with a Rockbiter Doomhammer every game is not really the way I wanted to see Shaman succeed personally.
It's not like this.
Yeah, not like this, but hey, I guess they'll get their moment if you're a diehard Shaman player, or if you never thought of playing that type of Shaman and you need 500 wins, now's the time, I guess.
Well, you either die the control deck or you live long enough to see yourself become the face Shaman. That's kind of how it is, right?
Well put.
It's like, at this point, the only way Shaman can survive is turning to the dark side. And, you know, we put that in quotation marks because... Shaman does get antagonized a little bit more, or, you know, just aggro in general, because the way it ends games is just so explosive. In fact, people kind of label the aggro Shaman as Hearthstone's first true burn deck, because it has so much direct damage that allows you to end the game so quickly. A lot of other things are kind of a built up of pressure on the board. So even Face Hunter, like, you have to build minions and charge the face. You have Kill Command and Quick Shot,
but that's about it. Yeah, but if you look at the Shaman deck now, they have three spells, right? They have Lightning Bolt, they have Lava Burst, and they have...
Flava Shock,
yes, thank you. And Flava Shock is mostly like a support spell. So I think you're kind of right, but I don't know if that would be like the tipping point for me. I'd be like, yeah, you know, it's a slightly more face oriented deck than Face Hunter in a lot of games.
Yeah, I think so. I think it's just in terms of what people feel like they're facing. It's definitely one of those things where if the Shaman gets to the point where they're just they have so much mana and they have like an ability to draw cards, it's almost lights out from there. But we'll go ahead and see what happens here. Looks like neither player queues up their Druid or Shaman. Instead, go with their most unreliable deck to try to get a quick win and move in those other reliable decks later. Rogue versus the Mage. This is not a matchup that I was anticipating seeing right off the bat here, Crypt.
No, but I'm pretty glad that we are. This is a pretty decent opener from Forsen. Not too bad. I don't actually see how this would get punished by the Rogue.
Not without Backstab, at least.
Mm.
Instead, I think you might end up passing. I don't think you want to do anything too drastic or hasty. A lot of people might look and be like, let's just remove the Mana Worm. But in the end, your opponent still has to be spending his turn playing spells. And without Unstable Portal to like immediately give that kind of synergy, you know, I think you're okay.
This is an excellent SI7 play. I was thinking that if Knife Juggler didn't get drawn, I think Prep may have been the best drawn deck for the Rogue to coin Prep Eviscerate and then play the Cleave as an 8-8.
Yeah, a very fast Van Cleave might be good too.
Alright, well the Mana Worm is well protected and it's just going to grow and grow. This is the Tunnel Trog classic version.
Yeah, the Tunnel Trog, the original Tunnel Trog. One drop.
Oh god. Yeah. Oh, the pain. The agony.
Well, I mean, it's still okay, because ultimately you're just trying to stall, and you definitely, as long as you pick up like Blade Flurry, you can always come back.
Sinister Strike.
Yeah. I mean, you're also lacking some other basic removals as well, like you don't have Flame Cannon, You don't have a lot of access to, well, obviously you don't have Mad Scientist for your secrets as well, so a lot of these like small tempo edges that you gain every single turn are just not as impactful, and yet Forsen's still able to win this game with Tempo Mage, so maybe he's onto something. Another thing that we didn't consider is we didn't see Forsen's top end. We didn't see what late game he has opportunity to close out, if it's Antonitis or Ronin or honestly, even Ragnaros sometimes.
Yeah, you're assuming there is top end.
Yeah, that's also a possibility because he has Arcane Blast and Mirror Image and Arcane Missiles. It could just be straight up aggro with the Tempo Mage.
Hmm. It looks like there might be some options here. Okay, so you can backstab a 0/2. You can hero power. Mm. You can deckhand into the other 0/2. You can then eviscerate the 4/4 and kill the Mana Worm with a 5/4. So you're left with a 5/2, a 2/1, and a weapon. It basically ends the game the way I see it. It needs a Flame Waker shenanigans again.
Yeah, I don't like leaving the Azure Drake up if you just backstab the if you backstab the 2/3.
It's a full clear here.
Yeah, I'm saying I don't like the other play. Because when you evaluate these plays... Oh, he's going for Van Cleef instead.
Oh.
Cool. I think this is okay, too. 6-6 is pretty reasonable, now that I evaluate it. Just the one thing about the Azure Drake play is that you leave up spell power, which just gives so much flexibility for this deck that you know runs a lot of spells. Oh. Well,
kill the Cleef, but I don't know if he will.
Yeah, you can go face. The mirror entity, the mirror image stalls for time. Wow, that's not bad either.
Yeah.
That's pretty good. The Eviscerate number 2 gives him an opportunity to go for this clear. I think you definitely take this one.
Yeah.
It's okay to dump your hand a little bit too, because you have Sprint to back it up, and Forsen is officially out of gas after this Forgotten Torch, so he needs something else.
It's going to be the Godbug Flame Waker into like the... Oh, I was going to say Arcane Intellect follow-up, but... All right, we can start with that.
Not bad.
Okay.
Someone order a Flame Waker. Fresh out of the oven.
Okay. Well, with Sprint, you can get a lot of options. We haven't seen any preps used, so you can get like a prep sap or something.
Yeah,
looks
so
like he's choosing not to go to the Sprint though.
I think it's just better to impact the board and then just really go for as high much value as you can. That's also pretty good too, getting the SI7 yep. agent. Oh man.
Well, it looks good, but the multiple one health minion strategy in this situation is not going to work out as well because the potential Flame Waker destruction.
This has to not hit face. Any other target's okay. Spell Slinger. Oh man, you're playing with fire, Forsen.
Yeah.
He wants Flame Waker to, like, he wants to get a spell so that Flame Waker can just completely wreck the board the following turn. Wanted, dead or alive. Okay. That's so funny. Cause now he can play Avenging Wrath with the Flame Waker next turn. You like Arcane Missiles, eat your heart out.
Yeah. That's 11 missiles. No, it's 10 missiles. It's the timepiece of horror.
For 6 mana?
For 9 mana. But you get a minion at the end.
Yeah. Pay attention. Alright, 2 Violet Teachers. And I'm almost certain the Drake will want to clear this out a little bit. So that's gonna be a lot of health onto the board, but I mean, I've got just the thing for this situation, Trip.
Actually, he can't clear, and there's no case where he clears. So the best case is it kills one Violet Teacher, but even that, I think, is pretty unlikely. So he has to get really lucky here for this to work out.
Oh, 2, 3, 4, 5 to the face. Oh, Forsen.
Well, man. Now he can get Arcane Intellect. Arcane Intellect, Frostbolt, Fireball, Lethal. There you go.
Yeah, it's just funny that that's the way it happened. And I guess because he did so much damage to the face, maybe he has an opportunity to kill.
Mm-hmm.
You know, surprisingly, I felt like...
Oh my god, he might sap that. He might sap that.
No. Do you want to sap the Flame Waker?
Yeah, I think you might. You have to close out this game fast.
I guess that makes sense because you're going to build up so many 1-1s too. So it's a higher chance that the Flame Waker misses base.
Right, but now with Flame Waker, he can get a Fireball and live the dream. That would be 1 in 64 Fireball lethal here.
Sounds reasonable. What?
Okay.
Is he going to Arcane Intellect immediately? Or is he going to Flame Waker?
If he Arcane Intellects immediately, he can draw into Frostbolt Fireball exactly for lethal. But if he plays the Flame Waker first and he gets a Fireball, he also has to get very lucky.
He can also play Knife Juggler, Flame Waker, Arcane Intellect, float 2 mana, but I think he used up almost all of his 1 mana spells.
Yeah, it's just that I think he probably knows he's dead next turn. So I think he has to make the most the play that gives him the best chance to win right now. Oh, nope.
Juggler has to redeem you, so I guess you play 1 Flame Waker and you ping.
Yeah, I guess.
Just try to go as hard as you can in the paint. Ping off the 2-1. There is 5, 8, 9, 13, 14, 15, 16 damage. That should be lethal. Oh, wait. I don't know if you can reduce the cost of stuff. Yeah, you can, right? Yeah, because if you attack in Blade Flurry with the Thanos, it kills the Knife Juggler, and that actually reduces the cost of Dragon's Breath to 4, so that should give you enough to get exact lethal. Right. Exact mana lethal.
Yeah.
There is a way to mess it up, too. If you, like...
He's one over lethal, actually.
Oh, the spell power on the Dragon's Breath, right?
Yeah.
Cool stuff.
So many options.
Yeah. Oh, is he styling on Forsen? I like it.
It's still lethal, technically, but that looked weird.
It's just a style. It's a style points, man. Because Forsen is the guy that always gets the extra BM in if he can. I'm ready to run. Oh, I like it. StrifeCro showing a little bit of flair here. Boom. Exact mana, one more floating, but an exact damage just for the icing on top. So that's going to put StrifeCro up to a 1-0 lead right now. With the rogue deck out
Not
of the way.
The rogue deck. Yeah. And that's a pretty big deal because these third decks are what are sinking a lot of these players. You know, some of them bringing priests, some warrior. Warrior's been pretty popular, unfortunately. And to get one right off the bat with your third deck, I think is very good. I mean, Druid and Shaman, just the two most winning decks of the tournament so far, without much of a surprise, honestly.
You asked for it.
Well, we'll see how good it is leading up to it. I think Forsen picked the Tempo Mage largely because he wants to be able to take advantage of the Druids. You know, the Druids being very slow on developing the tempo, if you have an ability to get early game plays, but you lose some of your best stuff. You lose Mad Scientist, Secret Poles, you lose Flame Cannons. Honestly, even Unstable Portal sometimes gives Druids such a big fate if you get a reasonable sized minion like a Bolt of Fist Ogre.
Well, you can still get those, it just has to be through Spellslinger.
Yeah, I guess so.
Or Conjure, I mean, it could happen here.
Yeah, Conjurer in general is just like a really underrated card when people first saw it, but now when they see more of it, it's like that card's just awesome. Not to mention, it's like in limited formats in a vacuum, it can give you some really powerful finishers that your opponent can't play around.
All right, well, the Living Roots keep, I guess it's not going to matter too much. How do you actually tackle this? Do you Living Roots? Do you double Living Roots and then get miserable?
Maybe just one Living Roots. The other Living Roots gives you flexibility to like kill a Sorcerer's Apprentice if you don't want to use Wrath. I mean, it depends on how you want to do it, but your opponent passes, essentially. So I think you're happy. Mm-hmm. You might even consider playing another Living Roots here, but
I kind of like the Wrath for one. You still don't have a good play next turn.
That's also a valid concern. What are you gonna do on 4 mana or up to 4 mana? What?
Yeah.
Followed by even the next 2 turns, because if you coin something out for 4 mana, that means you don't have anything on actual turn 4. So it's a valid concern.
Actually, Forsen also doesn't have really much. He just has the torch, but looks like there isn't going to be anything to torch. Oh, that's good.
There we go. We finally got something going. So, with Forgotten Torch, all of the 1-mana spells, it really feels like Forsen doesn't have any late game to his deck right now. Mm-hmm. And that might give Druid an opportunity to swing things if he just stabilize one turn. I imagine the Living Roots would come here, or actually Keeper of the Grove's not too bad here either. Keeper gives you some development proactively.
Yeah, I like the Keeper. The Keeper also doesn't die to the torch, which is pretty important. But looks like he's just going to Wrath the draw. And then Living Roots.
Okay.
No coin required.
He just really wants to improve the quality of his hand. Perfectly fine. But once again, slightly behind on the board, which means the mage can use removal to leverage that for more minion damage.
This is a very poor hand from StrifeCro. He's got a burn an Azure Drake here. And I mean there's really nothing. There's no one card that you can draw that you're really happy about.
Ooh, not a bad pickup at all for Forsen. Now that he has Azure Drake and the Arcane Blast, that's a full removal on the Azure Drake that's inevitably gonna follow up. Oh, never mind. Picked up something slightly better than that.
It's still quite good.
That would have been very bad.
It looks like he is just going with the Fireball.
But that, again, takes an entire turn of removal versus the Mage would have had Fireball in the hand and an Azure Drake developed onto the board. That would have been lights out, I think.
Well, we're probably going to see that here. Oh, no, we're not. Force of Nature taking out the Water Elemental. Wow.
Yeah, no more shenanigans. Realizing Mage is kind of low on cards, just needing to stabilize. But that's where Azure Drake is really powerful. It refills your hand a little bit. You can play the Mana Worm as well.
And the Mirror Image. I think Mirror Image is worth playing here. I'm surprised they did not play it. Oh! NC Tech! That could have been bad.
Forsen's next level play. I mean, he's aware that StrifeCro has cards like Mind Control Tech in his deck, too. Man, Arcane Blast is so strong here. 4, 8, 9, 16, 17 damage if he draws, Fireball. But it looks like this is just as good.
I wonder if he's going to play around MC Tech, though. He might. There's not much reason to taunt up here.
Well, it does two damage as opposed to the one with the ping.
Nope.
All right, here we go. Is there an opportunity for StrifeCro to stop this with Ancient of War or some kind of defensive maneuver, but it doesn't look like it.
Yeah, it doesn't look like it at all. I think his best out is probably to heal with the Ancient of Lore.
Right now there is 6 damage, 7 with the hero power, 9 if they both hit face with the mirror. Oh man. Is that guaranteed
lethal?
That's
guaranteed lethal. Yep. Yep, that'll do it.
Wow.
That's the one extra damage that he needed.
Boom, exacties. And he played around Mind Control deck, and he is BMing back saying, thank you, StrifeCro, for justifying my actions in the next game.
That was very well played by Forsen. I think almost everyone would have played that that mirror image, and if he had roughly half the time, I think he would have not been able to seal out that game. I think the MC Tech stopping the damage either through taking a taunt or taking a big minion would have given StrifeCro just enough time to swing it back as the druid. So good stuff. It's evened out, and both players are on their cookie cutter decks, I suppose. Is there much variation between these two? Forsen is running the Unbound Elemental with the Shaman, and that extra little bit of health, I think, could play a big factor in the mirror matchup. But for that to happen, you have to lose this one. So I don't know if he wants that.
Yeah, the Unbound Elemental is actually a very good card against Druid, something that people don't really immediately think when they see the Unbound, but it has a lot of power because it gains health as well as attack. Cards like the Tunnel Trog, the ultimate limitation of that is that it's not Undertaker by growing +1/+1, only +1 attack. But Unbound Elemental, if you just keep overloading, which over the next 3-4 turns looks like you can, that thing will just grow to be like a Pit Fighter or Boulder Fist Ogre status, and that's just going to seize enough tempo to run away with the game.
I don't think it's going to work. I think he's going to coin it out, and it's going to get Innervate Charge Druid the Clawed.
Oh yeah, assuming that doesn't happen. I'm just saying, as a rule of thumb, like this card can be pretty impactful. You don't really expect Innervate Charge Druid the Claw. You usually like expect maybe Innervate Swipe or some kind of silence play or something, but this is a fantastic response from StrifeCro. And he's also got a couple of good 4-drop opportunities here. With like being able to follow it up.
I wouldn't consider these very good.
I mean, he's not dying. He's eventually going to have much better quality minions too, because like Shaman at this point is not really doing much.
Yeah. He has the Lava Shock and then Totem Golem. And I guess you might as well trade, so you play around Swipe a little bit. But, I mean, all this is resulting in zero damage.
Yeah.
This is not a winning game right now for the Shaman, not in the least.
And, you know, ultimately, God, as long as you just stay safe.
Look at that Druid hand. Two pair.
Which is better than three high, last time I checked.
All right. There are some very clunky cards, but it will probably work out if he ends up keeping the Azure Drake. I just kind of have some doubts. Oh no! Looks like he will be keeping the Azure Drake.
I think he just probably realizes he's super far behind. Doesn't have the opportunity to play around that.
Mm-hmm.
He wants to just get the most damage he can as possible, and by doing so, he will be able to have Lava Burst hit face. I can get behind it.
What do you think is worth less, a Force of Nature or a Swipe? I think a Force of Nature, number two, is harder to use properly. I think you'll use a Force of Nature to clear here. Guess I'm wrong.
Well, the thing about that is the Force of Nature does the same thing as Swipe, but you get to get a hero power in. Mm. And you're not gonna you're probably going to be looking to play Swipe plus something else later on anyways. So I think the Force of Nature is still pretty useful. Trade onto the Azure Drake. And I wonder if he's just going to Swipe and play Mounted Raptor, or instead opt to use Force of Nature to be completely defensive. But I think the Swipe...
He has the option to draw the Claw again. He can draw the Claw charge and Hero Power down the 2-1, but Swipe does seem a little bit safer.
Flametongue Totem was a card that was included in several aggro shaman decks in the very beginning of it. It's iterations, but it phased out because they realized...
Don't you want a totem first if you get a taunt totem?
Yes. But he did it because he knew.
Okay.
Forsen can foresee what totem he's going to roll. This is special power, bro.
Alright.
Wow. Mind Control Tech stealing one of the taunted Feral Spirit Wolves. That's really brutal. And this game is almost just wrapped up. Druid's at too much health. There's still no sign of a Doomhammer being able to come back in the game. And pretty soon, Druid's going to flip the aggro switch to be aggressive.
Yeah, it's just the Shaman just couldn't really make anything happen.
Well, at least he's trying, Crip. But like at this stage, you're probably like rolling a Spell Power Totem to try and get to like kill off the Druid of the Claw. You might just die of Savage, or you might just drop it first.
You did get it.
I'm counting how much damage Force of Nature Savagery is, and it's way over lethal, so.
Yeah.
Nothing you can really do.
Earth Shock is okay, but then Ancient of War is going to give you clinical depression.
Yeah, that might be a side effect of using Earth Shock right here. Assuming you don't die the next turn, but yeah. Because that would be exactly lethal.
Ooh,
wow. Scenarios. Not even being necessary at all here.
No, I think I like the full clear. The full clear gets rid of the spell damage totem, which can actually be a pretty big deal.
Forsen seeing Ancient of War, not going to be able to do anything. Ancestral Knowledge draws more knowledge. Very metaphorical, you know?
Yeah.
Very good metaphor for life. That's about all the lessons that Forsen's learned, aside from the fact that he can't win this game. And all the knowledge in the world won't matter about that. It's going to wrap it up here. So, game of three just kind of led to the finish. It wasn't even remotely close. And that's just the power of that opening. being able to innervate that Druid of the Claw and being able to follow it up with some turn four plays to really just nullify any kind of early board, and then Shaman just was super far behind from that point on.
Well, Forsen definitely didn't want to lose there, but I do feel like he has favorable matchups against StrifeCro's last remaining deck, his own face Shaman. I think the Undead Elemental is a really, really nice advantage to have, just a lot more health than other minions that you would otherwise play. And, yeah, we've seen Druid does beat Shaman. One of the few decks that does.
Yeah, these kinds of matchups, they're super lightning fast. So I guess that's one of the things that you have to accept, that if you're not able to start off very quickly, you're once again going to fall really far behind. And the fact that Forsen didn't have a one drop is pretty significant.
Well, you can actually clear here. You can clear the Totem Golem. You can do his own Totem Golem and coin an abusive, and then next turn Totem Golem.
No, that's really big. That's a really good pickup there, Crip, and I think that's what he's going to do. Not to mention that Forsen will be behind on the board, because then he plays his own Totem Golem into what's very clearly a bad board for him. Mm-hmm. And this is another scenario where it's like, Unbound Elemental, if you're not able to get ahead of it, it can't snowball, therefore it's just... You might as well play Brand Bronzebeard, to be honest, yeah. Sometimes. It depends, you know, on what you're trying to go for. So he's going to play it and hope for the best, but...
The best is still pretty depressing.
Yeah. And
I mean, best case, you killed 3-1. Best case.
Yeah. Looking like you might kill 3-1, or you might just get juggled. And
juggled
for nothing.
That's even worse than the worst case that we imagined. Is there a reason to trade with that? I mean, I feel you're never gonna be bothered about Lightning Storm.
Maybe Knife Juggler and like Feral Spirits or something like that. I think he's just thinking there's too many ways where like the Flame Jugglers, the Knife Jugglers, that kind of stuff could really, you know, screw me over. And it's completely reasonable. Doom Hammer time. Although,
that's good.
You are a little bit afraid of the Tunnel Trog, but I don't know, man.
Nah, it's good enough.
I like the Doom Hammers.
Doom Hammer.
You know, you also get to put 4 damage to facepalm at 20, and you have Rock Biter, so I think I'm feeling pretty good.
Yeah.
The reason why is just because, it's like you pointed out in previous series, you just want to develop Doom Hammer much earlier than your opponent, because then you're going to be able to utilize your mana more efficiently. Otherwise, later on, Rock Biters and Doom Hammer heads just become more inefficient as you draw cards.
Okay. This would be a really good Flava Shock here.
Oh, well, Lightning Bolt is the only card you can play.
Oh, that's right.
You know, those Total Trogs are pretty intense, man.
They're going to be even more intense next turn.
Assuming they survive.
There's a few lethal opportunities here. Nope.
Well, I think you definitely want to at least kill one of the Trogs. So Lava Shock 1, Leopard Nomit. And then you probably just Feral Spirit and then just go face twice. You set up an opportunity to potentially draw into lethal. You'll have done 14 damage, and if you get Lava Burst, you win. And if the Feral Spirit Wolf survives, you only need to draw 3 more damage to win. So, I like putting it on a little bit of a clock there. Oh wait, I forgot about the Leopard Gnome damage. Leopard Gnome damage is pretty relevant too, so that's actually very good, the more I think about it. He's keeping Lava Shock so he can go face with it? Okay, I like that too.
Yeah.
I think he's understanding that Forsen's constricted on mana, so for him to get through is going to be really inefficient. Oh, man.
This is going to work out pretty well, though. Do you want Ancestral Knowledge? I just feel like those Trogs have enough attack. I think you might need just regular Totem. Or to, to Flame Tongue in between the taunts. I think I'd do that.
These Trogs are insane! You can't... We said that there's no targets to Big Game Hunter, really, in people's decks. I found
you were wrong! Yeah. Oh, Arcane Golem. Is that it? No.
He's one-off lethal, I think. Wait, what if he gets a Spell Power Totem? If he gets a Spell Power Totem, it's lethal. Right?
Yes. No, yes. Yes. Spell Damage Totem is lethal, because the Lava Shock pays for itself. 1 in 4 lethal here.
And you can play it because you have the exact 7 mana with that.
Yep. Spell Damage is lethal.
Okay, well, I guess you want to kill one of the Trogs. Like, those things are pretty sick, man. Like, you don't want that to become a 9 damage Trog or worse. Gosh.
Okay, looks like he's gonna limit him on one minion.
Yeah, he doesn't want to turn.
Oh, man. Oh, this Trog can do it. Jesus. This Trog can do it.
Lava Shock?
Lava Shock, I think, is lethal.
Lava Shock? That'd be so sick!
Oh, is that it? It's 11. It's plus 2? 11? No, it's not.
Oh, he's so close! He doesn't have enough mana!
Yeah. He has to, get a Taunt Totem and not die now.
Oh!
You win.
Wow!
Wow! Totem RNG.
It's like, well, it's funny because you got the spell power totem that StrifeCro wanted for the lethal, and then StrifeCro the totem which with Forsen wanted. A little bit of iron close out that game, but StrifeCro does end up closing out that series here 3-1, and he too moves on to the final day, which is pretty cool. You know, StrifeCro hasn't actually had many decent results recently, and he's known primarily as like a strong constructed player first. Not necessarily known as a streamer, compared to what Forsen these days is primarily priding himself in. So a much needed victory for him. But Forsen still has another chance. He's definitely been playing really well. Loved his Tempo Mage game. And it's going to come down to whether or not he can defeat Amnesiac coming up here in the series after this grip.
Yeah, it's going to be Forsen versus Amnesiac. And it's going to be followed by Kibler versus Tice afterwards. Those two matches will dictate... two more players moving on to the final day of the tournament. And if you're just tuning in, make sure to tune in all 3 days. Today, we're just about wrapped up with Group A. Tomorrow, we'll have another 8 players play for the first time. We'll get to see what kind of creations they bring. And then we're going to match it all up together on the final day 3 afterwards.
All right, so give a big shout-out again to Geek Fuel as well as the Curse Network for supporting the tournament. Check out their stuff. It's plastered all over the event, so make sure at least to stop by and take a peek so that way you can continue to support them to support us for the event. Appreciate you guys for tuning in so far. We'll be back with more action here at the Curse Trials. Stay tuned.